بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Good afternoon everyone. This is a special course and a special day about nephroradiology. I'm pleased to have this collaboration between different societies, between Egyptian Society of Nephrology and Transplantation, Egyptian Society of Nephrology and Transplantation, Egyptian Society of Radiology and Nuclear Medicine, and Mansoura Faculty of Medicine, Continuous Medical Education. And we are going to start today with this small introduction. Why we need radiology and nephrology? Because this is one of the most important tools to reach the diagnosis. And always, in all nephrology activities organized here at Urology and Nephrology Center or in any nephrology congress, we should collaborate and to have pillars from radiology aspects. Professor Tarek Diasti, Professor of Radiology at Urology and Nephrology Center, Mansoura University, is a unique person. He's unique because he has a well-known established school in radiology of the genitourinary tract. He's the president of Egyptian Society of Radiology and Nuclear Medicine for the second round as a president. He's as well the president of African Society of Radiology. We are honored here at Urology and Nephrology Center at Mansoura University and in Egypt to have this man and his fellows and associate here at the center. Always, Professor Tayyip Diasti learned us a lot about the radiology. And as I said to you, it is a complementary. We work in a team because together achieves more. Professor Ablughar, from the starting point of all nephrology courses at Urology and Nephrology Center and with African countries, because we have collaboration with African countries for many years through the Ministry of Exterior here in Egypt. And this is one of the workshops about the ultrasound. So no nephrology and no renal examination. Ultrasound of the kidney is not investigation. It is a clinical examination tool. As nephrologists, we should know how to examine the kidney by ultrasound. And we may consult a specialist in radiology just to refine some difficult cases. So always we are working in collaboration with radiologists. And this is Professor Ablughar just testing his jugular veins by ultrasound. And this is what we do in nephrology surface at Mansoura, either in Urology and Nephrology Center or Mansoura University Hospital. We introduce catheters, not blinded, but ultrasound guided for the security and the safety of the maneuvers and for the welfare of the patients. So always Professor Ablughar is a unique person and he is a talented and well known by his tendency to for giving attitude. And this is Dr. Hashim during the training of some of the African guys about to use ultrasound to test the inferior vena cava diameter. So through the last years, we are focusing on what is known BOCUS. What is BOCUS? It is point of care ultrasound. What's meant by point of care ultrasound? It is to have ultrasound at the hand just to look rapidly on the organs like kidney, liver, and here in nephrology, we are interested by neck veins, fistula examination, as well as cardiology and IVC. In cardiology, as I like it, the echocardiogram in 30 seconds, just 30 seconds, both the probe, you can see the heart. If the heart is pumping like this, and the mitral valve is opening and closing, it's okay. Systolic function is good. If there is no calcifications in the valve, there is no valvular calcification. If there is no black shadow behind the heart, there is no pericardial effusion. So as nephrologist, I can say systolic function is okay just by the eye globe evaluation. No effusion, or there is effusion, and sometimes you will pick up huge effusions, and you can detect signs of collapse in ultrasound, denoting ultrasound signs of pericardial tamponade, and as well as the calcifications of the valves. So all these are important and complementary to the nephrology service. This is Dr. Mu'tasim, and one of the smart specialists here at Eurasian Nephro Center, helping us in the training of the African guys about the use of echocardiogram. And this is the short axis view showing the aorta and the pulmonary vessels. So it is easy. Ultrasound is nowadays an evolving issue in nephrology care. And there are many papers and articles showing that ultrasound is important, as the ultrasound can tell us about pleural effusion and lung congestion by assessing beta Kurler's line. And this is one of the demonstration. As you see, it is easy to know lung and pleura and pleural effusion. Another issue in the ultrasound is IVC diameter and collapsibility index, just to see the 2D dimension. This is the inferior vena cava, and this is the diameter with difference in the dimension of the inferior vena cava, and we can apply the collapsibility index. So IVC diameter is one of the important tools to guide us to know the volume status of our patients, to the extent that some centers train the nurse. Just the nurse hold the probe in this position, both the probe, you can know the IVC diameter. If IVC diameter is wide, this means that there is volume overload. This is the most recent guidelines for vascular access. And we are going to summarize this in our next meeting on October 4th in the Kalei Nephrology Group meeting to highlight the new issues about the applied practice guidelines of the vascular access. And I bought this just to say, examining the fistula by Doppler give us the impression about the fistula evaluation. Is it good fistula? Is it poor fistula? Or it is hyperdynamic fistula, according to the volume of the blood within the fistula. This is after fistula creation. Before fistula creation, we can use ultrasound to know the adequacy and the competency of the vessels for the fistula. Other area for collaboration with radiology is to test by conventional images to know calcification by Blaine X-ray, as I just mentioned, by ultrasound to detect the calcifications within the valve. So vascular calcification is one of the important and very catastrophic issue, because it is complicated by cardiovascular outcome, heart endpoints, and even mortality. And when vascular calcification is established, the treatment is not satisfactory. And this just to show you Blaine X-rays. So the radiology in nephrology practice is not just to do ultrasound for the kidney. So Blaine X-ray, and today Dr. Abdullah will give us a very detailed talk about the conventional images in nephrology. So this is the vascular calcification. I think it is crystal clear there is vascular calcification. Vascular calcification, the vessels are drawn. These are the vessels. So you can just, the Blaine X-ray, you can detect the calcification everywhere, either in the intima or the media. And this is the CT scan showing cardiac calcification, and it is an essential tool. The most recent and released guidelines about chronic kidney disease, mineral bone disorders, this is always we use American, European, but this is Chinese guidelines that is released on July this year, that we should focus on vascular calcification. And vascular calcification, cardiovascular calcification assessment is recommended for patients with significant hyperphosphatemia, requiring individualized high dose phosphorus binding agents, especially in dialysis. And this is a suggestion I'm not going to discuss in details, but I just want to express my feeling about the need of radiology and the collaboration between the nephrology and radiology. What is this? Anyone from the nephrology side, from the participants, would like to comment? If any one of the candidates want to comment on this radiology and the concomitant pathology, I'll be happy. Dr. Hadidi, what is this and what that?
حضرتك البيوبسي اللي على اليمين انا شايف دي كلوميريولس واللي داخل كده ارتريول تقريبا في ثيكنينج للانتنا في ناروينج لليومن بتاع الارتري.
اوكي سو ذس از ذا ريفرنس اند ذس از ذا ايمج وذ نيو انجلاند جورنال اوف ميديسن. طارق زيان، دكتور طارق زيان.
السلام عليكم.
وعليكم السلام.
حضرتك انا شايف في السي تي المعموله دي اللي هي اللاترال فيو في فاسكولار كلاسيفيكيشن، واخد الاورطه كلها حتى بالبرانشز بتاعتها ونازل على الدومين الاورطه، وبعدين عندك البلاد فيزل واضح فيها خالص كوليسترول امبلاي قافله في البلاد فيزل، ودي تفسر ان ممكن يكون العيان عمل انجيوبلاستي ولا حاجه.
ثانك يو فيري ماتش دكتور طارق، بس اكشولي يو بيك اب رينال دايجنوسيس. It is acero-embolic renal disease because here the cholesterol cleft, okay?
Yeah.
Acero-embolic renal disease, but this is not vascular calcification. This is an operation done for transcatheter valve replacement. So, anyhow, if we use a contrast and angiography, and the patient complicated by acute renal failure, we should know the time between the intervention and the occurrence of acute renal failure. If this contrast induced or associated acute kidney injury, this will occur within few days, within 1 day or 2 days within the intervention. But if there is latent period or interval between the intervention and the diagnosis of acute renal failure, we should put in mind the atheroembolic renal disease. And the question to Dr. Tariq Zayan, why we have cholesterol cleft in this case?
لان حضرتك المفروض ما بنحط الصبغه بتاعت اللي هي دي الدي باس ستين، مفترض ان بيحصل ديزولف للمنطقه بتاعت الكوليسترول فبتسيب مكانها كليفت.
So just to refine the answer, yes, because of preservation. It dissolves preservation in paraffin section, dissolves cholesterol. So this is a vessel occluded. We can find it in the vessel or in the small vessel within the glomerulus or vessels here. So the vessel is completely occluded. And this is not a lumen. It is a cleft or a space left after dissolving of cholesterol. This is why it is cholesterol embolic syndrome. Just not to be long in the introduction, as I mentioned, we are not restricted to ultrasound of the kidneys, ultrasound of jugular veins, but if you look here, what is this? Dr. Ihab?
Biopsy.
What is this modality, Dr. Ihab?
Ultrasound.
I know it is ultrasound for
also for muscle.
For what?
Muscle.
Perfect. Do you know what the difference between this ultrasound and this ultrasound?
fibrosis and في grade 1
as thank you very much Dr. Ihab. As we comment on the renal parenchyma by echogenicity and the grade of echogenicity, we have echogenicity for the muscle. So this is grade 1 increased echogenicity of the muscle, and the muscle here is completely white. This means grade 4 echogenicity. So when the muscle is hyper echogenic, this means that muscle fibers are replaced either by fat or fibers. So it is either myosteatosis or myofibrosis. Nowadays we are lucky because we have here at Mansoura University Hospital three doctors trained, three physicians trained on muscle ultrasound. And by applying muscle ultrasound in rheumatology and in nephrology, we can know the status of the muscles. And instead of waiting until we find the muscle atrophy by clinical examination, again and again, all these by radiology. This is a patient on diabetic on dialysis with uncontrolled hyperglycemia. The patient presents with the swollen tender left side, and it was published in the clinical nephrology case studies this year. This is an MRI of the thigh. This is T1. Here you can find hypointensity. And I think in the lecture of MR, I will know all these principles. And this is MRI after fat suppression. What is the difference? The difference is there is increase and excess intensity here after fat suppression. This means that we are dealing with edema. So it is edematous muscle. So this is a syndrome, diabetic myonecrosis. If we have a patient who is diabetic, diabetes state is uncontrolled, and then presents with pain and the tenderness of the muscle, we should be systematic to have Doppler to exclude DVT, to screen for the serology, for the immunology markers, for the collagen disorders, vasculitis, lupus, ATC. And if all these are not the explaining the diagnosis, we shouldn't forget the concept of myonecrosis. Here I have a question. If this is the case, and the MRI is suggestive of this diagnosis, don't forget that we'll start with ultrasound, because ultrasound will pick up collection and abscess or the any problem that can be detected by ultrasound, like DVT. And then MRI. If MRI by T1 weighted images, that will be explained later within the, I think, in the second week or third week, I'm not remembering the schedule. So the rules will know what's meant by T1 and T2. So this is hypointense, and this is fat suppression technique. And here there's more and more intensity. So it is edema, and this may denote myonecrosis, or it is myonecrosis. The gold standard for diagnosing myonecrosis is biopsy. So do you recommend doing biopsy for this case? If you have MRI like this, why? Biopsy is the gold standard for diagnosis, but we don't need it after this MRI finding. So this is the beauty of radiology. So why we don't do biopsy after this MRI sign? Because biopsy will not add anything, but it will add harm. What is harm in hell? It will delay recovery, because at the end it is biopsy invasive. So here the biopsy will not add anything, will not add predictive role, and it will hinder or postpone the recovery. This is the case, this is the last part of my introduction. The interplay between gadolinium and the kidney, and the syndrome of nephrogenic systemic fibrosis is already known since many years. So this is a 51-year-old male presented with a 3-week history of progressive pain, pruritus, and swelling in his feet, accompanied by a feeling of tightness. The patient had a past medical history of indecision and disease, secondary to uncontrolled type 2 diabetes. 4 weeks ago, the patient had undergone magnetic MR imaging for a suspected intracranial tumor. Physical examination revealed the bilateral sclerosis of the distal feet with diffuse keratotic white plaques, coalescing into plaques and cobblestoning. There were underlying areas of erythema and hyperpigmentation. A skin biopsy revealed a thickened dermis, dermacollagen bundles arranged haphazardly, proliferation of dermal spindle cells that stain positive for CD34 and procollagen 1, and interstitial myosin deposition within the deep dermis, where scattered histocytes and multinucleated giant cells, fibrosis extended from the dermis into the subcutaneous fat. So this is a classic nephrogenic fibrosing dermopathy. Why dermopathy? Because here this is a documentation of scleroderma-like pathology. If this is associated with internal organ fibrosis, we will change from nephrogenic fibrosing dermopathy to nephrogenic systemic fibrosis. Why we say nephrogenic? Because we will find this syndrome after gadolinium administration if the patient has well-established renal failure, estimated GFR less than 30 or even less than 15 milli per minute, and or if the patient is on dialysis or if there is acute renal failure. So this is why we say nephrogenic. Why we have this syndrome? Because gadolinium after administration dissociate from the complex and engulfed by the fibrocytes leading to this fibrosis. I want just to show the most updated. This is one of the radiology articles showing the type of gadolinium-based contrast agents. These are the different names. In the past, we have here at Urology and Nephrology Center Mansoura, gadidomide under the name of Omniscan. And it is after the series of Professor Tariq Diasti presentations, he replaced gadolinium by one of the newer agents. So just to summarize, this is the Canadian guidelines for nephrogenic systemic fibrosis. This is the cut-edge information. They classify gadolinium into three generations. First generation, second generation, and third generation. First generation gadolinium, one of the examples of first generations is gadidomide. Gadidomide is obsolete and is replaced by one from the new second or third generation. What is the implication of this on the practice? What is new? Informed consent, because this was the standard of care. If we will give gadolinium for a patient with end-stage kidney disease, especially on dialysis, the patient should consent on gadolinium and the risk of nephrogenic fibrosis. Here, after the use of new generations, informed consent prior to administration of group 2 gadolinium-based contrast agents or third generations for the risky patients, for patients who is not recommended. So we are not afraid of nephrogenic systemic fibrosis. Even screening for renal dysfunction with questionnaire and serum creatinine prior to administration of group 2 gadolinium-based contrast agents or third generation is not recommended. So this guidelines and this commentary on the guidelines give us assurance that the new gadolinium agents are more safer. Even when we had in the past gadidomide in the center, the expert here in radiology, Professor Dust and his associates are wise in their use. Because one of the most important risk factor is the dose of gadolinium. So they are acquainted here. The school of the center is to use the minimum dose that's sufficient for diagnostic purposes. This is a well-dedicated course and will be conducted, as I mentioned in the beginning, under the umbrella of Egyptian Society of Radiology and Nuclear Medicine, with the Egyptian Society of Nephrology and Transplantation, Mansoura Faculty of Medicine, Continuous Medical Education, and the team of Urology and Nephrology Center. And we are honored to have Professor Tariq Dust with us, Professor Mohammed Abul Ghar as a course director, and all these activities under the patronage of Professor Mohammed Hani Hafiz, the president of the Egyptian Society of Nephrology and Transplantation. And it is a promise that all the presentations will be captured, and you will find it within the domain of the Egyptian Society of Nephrology and Transplantation, and will be available for Professor Tariq Dust to distribute to the radiology societies, Egyptian and African. And this is if you go to this site, you will find online for radiology course, and day after day you will find the data. And at the end of the course, for the nephrologists, and I leave the radiologists for Professor Tariq Dust, for nephrologists to have the certificate from Egyptian Society of Nephrology and Transplantation, all nephrologists should pass the exam. It is open book exam for one day at the end of the course. At the end, this is our task, is to enhance education and training, because a doctor is a student until he dies. Once he considers himself not a student anymore, the doctor inside him dies. And thank you very much for your attention, and I'll be happy to have any question. Any question, Mufassal? مش أسئلة؟ دكتور عبد الله؟ So allow me, before starting the second presentation today, just to introduce Professor Tariq Dust to welcome you all. Professor Tariq.
Yes, okay. Good afternoon, everyone. It is my pleasure to welcome you all in this course. We are planning to have a very fruitful nephro radiology course. For it will be of value for nephrologists and radiologists. And it is my pleasure to work with Professor Hussein and the Nephrology Society in Egypt. And also, I'd like to extend this information to the Egyptian Society of Radiology, as well as the African Society of Radiology. And I hope it will be very useful, of course. And thank you so much.
Professor Tariq Dust promised us to have a second wind of advanced course. And I think in the advanced course, it will be a special course with collaboration from European and from radiology community. And I leave the Professor Tariq to introduce the next speaker.
So it is, I'm pleased to introduce Dr. Abdallah Shadi. He's a lecturer in radiology, urology and nephrology center here in Mansoura. So Dr. Abdallah will introduce the conventional radiology of the renal tract. So please stop.
Assalamu alaikum. Is there any question, Mufassal?
Regarding the biopsy to solidify the diagnosis of nephrogenic fibrosing dermopathy or nephrogenic systemic fibrosis, we are lucky nowadays because since 2008, it is vanishing syndrome. But if we have, and Professor Tadassi can correct me, if we have a patient with gadolinium-based investigation within a few days, and then he presents with the changes in the skin and the scleroderma-like presentation, I think we don't need biopsy to solidify the diagnosis. But we may go in the spiral of evaluation. So just to pick up, is it scleroderma? Because you may have systemic disease. If it is just linked to patient with advanced adrenal failure, especially patients on dialysis, complicated by skin lesion, simulating scleroderma, I think it is not necessarily to have biopsy. Do you agree? Ah, it's okay. So there is no need for biopsy to confirm, and I assure you the syndrome is vanishing. Nothing in today. So, but beware that there are some centers who are still using gadolinium. So if we are using gadolinium, we should be careful. In this scenario, I think for the nephrologists with us, there is a practical advice. If I have a patient on hemodialysis and he is subjected or she is subjected to gadolinium based using gadolinium, because this is what you have, so what we do? We should collaborate with the radiologist. Please use the smallest dose as you can. And then one dose of hemodialysis is not sufficient to get rid of gadolinium. So we need three, this is not evidence based medicine, it is expert opinion, to do three consecutive daily dialysis to get rid of 95% of the gadolinium. But one session is not enough. And for patients treated by peritoneal dialysis, in this situation, we may temporarily shift it to hemodialysis. Professor,
other opinion. In patients with high risk to develop nephrogenic systemic fibrosis, it should not be injected linear kinase. Should not be.
Yes.
And there is no multicentric randomized study that can prove that dialysis can clear or can prevent the development of nephrogenic systemic fibrosis. So patient with high risk to develop NSF, we shouldn't administrate linear kinase. It should be cyclic.
So this is what the Western community recommend. No gadolinium, the newer agents, either second generation or third generation to be used. If you use second or third generation, don't be afraid. And use the hemodialysis modalities as you do. But if you are obliged to use the gadolinium because this is the only agent in your country, we can follow the expert opinion in the nephrology, but it is not an evidence business. And again, we should avoid this gadolinium, as Professor Dusty did here. Since how many years we replaced gadolinium?
Maybe 10 years.
So since 10 years, Urology and Nephro Center at Mansoura University replaced gadolinium by the newer agent in gadolinium. So this is the best way to prevent occurrence of nephrogenic systemic fibrosis. I leave now the stage to my colleague and friend, Dr. Abdullah, and I am sure that it will be a fruitful presentation.
Thank you.
Welcome everyone. The first lecture in the nephroradiology course will be conventional radiology of the urinary tract. It is an imaging techniques using X-ray to view the internal form of an object. In spite of the wide availability of CT and MRI in every radiology department, conventional radiology are still the most widely obtained imaging studies because it is inexpensive and available anywhere by using portable and mobile machine. X-ray require X-ray source and require method to record the images. The conventional imaging techniques of the urinary tracts include UTB, urinary tract plane, or QB, which means kidney, ureter, and bladder, IVU, cystography, and urethrography, and other imaging modalities include anterograde bilography, retrograde bilography, and lobography. I start by this slide, which show the main basic dynasties in X-ray. In X-ray, we using two terms, radiolucent and radioopaque. Radiolucent means black, and radioopaque means white. And according to this base, the different object in every X-ray film absorb X-ray by different ways. The air absorb the least X-ray, so it appear black, while the metallic object or contrast media absorb all X-ray, and so it appear radioopaque or appear white. In between, we have different tissues, including the fat and soft tissue and the fluids. Here, the soft tissue dynasty in this film. This is the liver, and this is the spleen, and this is the urinary bladder containing the fluid. The most natural occurring material that absorb X-ray, which is the bone, number four here. At the beginning, we should know how to take proper scout film or proper QV film. It must include the last two ribs or the suprarenal area, and include the area below the symphysis pubis to image the whole urinary tract. In this film, we can see the last two ribs and the area below the symphysis pubis. In some patients who are very long patients, in spite we use the long cassette in the radiology, which is 47 cassette. The area included in this film not include the area below the symphysis pubis. In spite of the problem of the patient is acute retention of the urine. So in this case, we need another additional film, which is pelvic film. In this patient, the problem of the patient, which is this radiopaque stone at the posterior urethra. So in some situation, we may need another additional film. In this patient, the patient come to our department by the problem. The problem of the patient is severe right renal colic in anteroposterior view. The patient is reported as normal, while if we add this oblique film, you can see the radiopaque calcular shadow along the course of the right pelvic ureter, which is the problem of the patient and the cause of the renal colic. Another additional film we may need, which is open bladder film, which can show the area of the posterior ureter, and in the course of the posterior ureter there is radiopaque shadow, which is the cause of the acute obstruction in this patient. In some patients which come to in emergency cases, in which no preparation of the patient, in this patient the area of the left kidney appear well, while the area of the right kidney there is multiple intestinal gases which obscure obscure the renal shadow. In this patient, we need another film, which is conventional tomogram. In the tomogram film, we in this area we aim to obtain the image at a certain level and by blurring the tissue in front and behind the this level. So you can compare between the two film. In this film, there is multiple intestinal gas in front of the kidney. While in this this film, you can see the shadow of the right kidney appear clear, and the shadow of the left kidney, and this is the shadow of the liver, and the shadow of the spleen. In every QB film, we must comment in the on the presence or absence of calcification and the abnormal soft tissue shadow, air within the urinary tract, and bony abnormalities. This example of radiopaque calcular shadow at both renal region. In this kidney, we have radiopaque calcular shadow as appear here, and the left kidney contains staghorn stone. In some cases, the radiopaque calcular shadow take the distribution of medullary pyramids. In this case, which is medullary nephrocalcinosis, or it occurs in the patient with hyperparathyroidism, renal tubular acidosis, medullary spongy kidney, renal papillary necrosis, and other causes include bony metastasis, hyperthyroidism, and hypercalcemia, malignancy, nephrotoxic drugs, and sarcoidosis, sickle cell anemia, vitamin D excess. And this is another example of radiopaque calcular or radiopaque shadow, calcific shadow at the region of the left kidney related to lower bowel of the kidney with abnormal distribution. And this is by complementary ultrasound. It appears that there is a lower bowel soft tissue mass with calcific foci inside, which is renal cell carcinoma. Another example for calcific shadow, which takes the distribution of vascular calcification in the both kidneys in patient with hyperparathyroidism. In this patient, anteroposterior view show radiopaque calcific shadow at the course of the left pelvic ureter, which is at the course of the iliac ureter, which is iliac ureteric stone. Another film for another patient with radiopaque calcific shadow at the course of the pelvic ureteric stone. Another form of calcification, which takes a butterfly appearance, which is the seminal vesicle calcification, and another calcification at the vas deferens here. And this is calcification of both seminal vesicle. Example of calcification at the wall of the urinary bladder, and butterfly appearance of calcification in the seminal vesicle. In some patients, we have radiopaque calcular shadow at the right renal or right hypochondrial region. This radiopaque calcification may be renal stone or gallbladder stone. In this situation, we need the lateral view film, which can differentiate between gallbladder stone and renal stone. In this patient, the stone appears anteriorly, so it is gallbladder stone, not renal stone. If it is renal stone, it will be overlay the vertebral column. And also in this patient, we can see this calcification, which takes the along the course of the aorta, denoting aortic calcification. The second item in Belen X-ray, we comment on the soft tissue shadow. In this patient, we can see the soft tissue shadow of the liver and both kidneys here, spleen, and this is the sore shadow. Any abnormalities in the soft tissue shadow, we can detect any pathology like this case, in which there is a large soft tissue shadow at the left renal region. This soft shadow displays the intestinal gases upward and medially. So I suspect abdominal mass. By ultrasound, we can detect this large renal mass, which is
This is mass which is renal mass and displacing the intestinal lumen upward and medially. Again, another case which in this case we have, this is the renal shadow, right renal shadow, and this is the left renal shadow. But the right and the left renal shadow are enlarged, and there is multiple calcification. By complementary ultrasound, we find bilateral hydronephrosis and bilateral calcification. And the diagnosis of this case is bilateral hydronephrosis with which by investigation it diagnosed as TB hydronephrosis. The third item, which is air within the urinary tract, the cause of the air in the urinary tract may be any fistula with the urinary tract. It may be from the GIT or any air containing the organ in the abdomen. Another cause is gas forming the organism, and in some cases like bladder substitute, in which after radical cystectomy, and in this case the vesicular reflux cause the direction of the air in retrograde way from the bladder to the ureter and the kidneys. Like this case, there is air distribution opacify the upper calyx, middle calyx, and the lower calyx, and along the renal pelvis and the ureter. So this the diagnosis of this case is emphysematous pyelonephritis. And another case with bilateral air within the urinary tract, in upper calyx, middle calyx, lower calyx, renal pelvis, in both sides. The diagnosis is bilateral emphysematous pyelitis. Before ending our report in Blinex Ray, we must comment on the bone detection of any pathology like bony metastasis or spinal abnormalities which may be related to the urinary tract, like this case in which there is a sclerotic bony lesion at the lumbar fifth lumbar vertebra, another sclerotic bony lesion here in the sacrum and along the pelvic bone. Sclerotic bony lesion means sclerotic metastasis, which is very common in prostate cancer. Another example for bony metastasis, which is in this case, there is multiple lytic lesion involving the both iliac bone and all pelvic bone and the upper femur. This lytic bony lesion, which is diagnosis of lytic bony metastasis, may be related to the urinary tract or to other organ. But in every male patient above 50 years, if we found sclerotic bony metastasis, we must be directed to the prostate cancer. Another example in this case, which is a child, we found that there is wide separation of both of the symphysis grooves here. By comparing this case, the symphysis grooves is closed, but in this case, the widely separated symphysis grooves it is associated with in child cases with bladder extrophy. The using of X-ray also to diagnose the place of the WG oleuretric stent. In this case, we found bilateral WG stent in place. It is the upper coil seen at the renal pelvis of the right kidney. Also on the left side, and the lower coil of both WG are seen in the urinary bladder, which is important to diagnose the placement of both WG stent after the operation. The second item is intravenous urography. After the widespread of the CT and the MRI in every radiology department, the use of the IVU has many limitations in some cases, like renovascular hypertension, breast enlargement, urinary tract infection, pelvic abdominal masses, and the role of the IVU in diagnosis of some cases of renal colic, renal trauma, and hematuria and obstructive uropathy. After widespread of the CT and the MRI, the role of the IVU become limited. But until now, the role of the eye view is still indicated in some cases, like before the urological procedures and before the ESWL, and in the urological procedures, the urologist needs to know the relation between the stone and the calyces. If it is seen at the anterior or posterior calyx and the approach to this calyx, the another use for the eye view is to comment on the state of the renal papilla and the minor calyces, which you not seen at in the MRI and the old CT. Also the complex congenital anomalies and possible urinary tract fistulas. Before any eye view film, we must take a scout film, which is a Belen X-ray film. Like in this case, there is a large radio opaque calcular shadow at the left renal region. If we, after injection of contrast media and contrast excretion, the stone obscured by the contrast media. So before comment on the eye view film, we must see the Belen X-ray film to not miss any radio opaque stones after injection of contrast media. Eye view film, we can comment also, or we can see the renal size by comparing both sides to the right kidney is equal in size to the left kidney. Also the hair after injection of contrast media, the contrast excretion by both kidneys are normal. Also the kidney position, which is the direction of the kidney, is the normal direction of both kidneys is directed downward and laterally. Any deviation from this direction means congenital anomaly, like this case. In this normal case, the direction is directed downward and laterally, but here the direction of the kidney is directed downward and medially. The diagnosis of this case is horseshoe kidney. Also, in this Belen X-ray film, there is soft shadow of the right kidney, soft shadow of the left kidney, and there is the renal stone here in the lower calyx of the left kidney. After injection of contrast media, the direction is directed downward and medially, and both kidneys are fused here in front of the vertebral column. The diagnosis is horseshoe kidney. Another case, the right kidney is seen at its normal anatomical site, while the left kidney is not seen at its site. After taking this pelvis film, the left kidney is seen ectopic at the left iliac region with hydronephrosis. This is the left kidney in abnormal site. Another example, the left kidney is seen at its normal anatomical site, while the right kidney is seen here at the right iliac region. Also in this case, the right kidney is ectopic in the pelvic, in the right pelvic region. In eye view film, we can comment in the renal parenchyma. Like in this case, the right kidney appear, the renal parenchyma appear homogeneous, while in the left renal parenchyma, there is rounded space occupying lesion, which appear lucent comparing to the renal parenchyma. And in this kidney, the left kidney, there is rounded space occupying lesion, but it appear more dense than the renal parenchyma. The radiolucent space occupying lesion is diagnosis of renal cyst because it is empty space and do not take contrast media, while this radio dense space occupying lesion, it means there is soft tissue inside this space occupying lesion, which means left renal mass may be benign or malignant. In eye view film, we also in the report, we must comment on the renal parenchyma as the excretion of contrast media. In this film, In spite we wait more than 10 minutes. The normal excretion start after 3 minutes. In this case, we wait more than 10 minutes, and the both renal parenchyma appear faint and no contrast excretion, which is as a radiological term, resistant nephrogram. If it appear bilaterally, the cause may be hypotension or impaired renal function. Another case with unilateral resistant nephrogram. In this case, the right kidney appear dense and no contrast excretion comparing to the left kidney. So here there is a right resistant nephrogram, which is diagnosis of many maybe urinary tract obstruction, renal artery stenosis, renal vein thrombosis, or ATN, or acute pyelonephritis. All of these causes may cause resistant nephrogram. Types of nephrogram, we have faint resistant nephrogram. The cause is hypotension or impaired renal function, increasing dense nephrogram. The term increasing dense nephrogram means by the time the density of the kidney increased. This occurs in distal obstruction, maybe due to ureteric stones, renal artery stenosis, and renal vein thrombosis. Immediate dense nephrogram means the kidney appears hyper dense from the start, and by the time it remains the same density, it occurs in acute tubular necrosis and acute pyelonephritis. Striated nephrogram means that there is area of the kidney are opacified, and there is another area not opacified. It occurs in acute pyelonephritis, acute in cases of autosomal recessive polycystic kidney disease, and in medullary sponge kidney. Also in eye view, we can see the pelvic calcium system. This is the right kidney, upper calyx, middle calyx, lower calyx, and this is the ureter down to the bladder. The left kidney, there is upper calcium, upper there is duplex left kidney, upper moiety and lower moiety, and there is it is not complete duplex because the both ureter may unite here. And there is the abnormality in this case is this filling defect in the lower calyx. This filling defect means that there is something no abnormal inside the pelvic calcium system. In this area, it is seen at the lower calyx. This filling defect by ultrasound, there is lower calcium stone. Another example with large filling defect that erodes the calyces and the renal pelvis and extends to the renal pelvis, which is large lower calcium and renal pelvis tumor. While the upper calyx here at the opacify normal. Okay. And there is calcific shadow at Belenix ray field. Another example for filling defect here in the left renal pelvis. This filling defect of left renal pelvis tumor. Another example for lower calcium tumor. The upper calyx here appear amputated. Here, the amputated upper calyx due to upper calcial urothelial tumor. This slide show the role of the eye view in diagnosis of acute papillary necrosis. Here, there is opacification of the renal papillary here. As we see, this is opacification of the renal papillary, and appear more here in this slide. The second stage is parenchymal cavities here, and the separation of the renal papillary. The third stage of after separation of renal papillary, it appear here in the upper in the calcial group. This is all of these filling defects are separated renal papillae, which is mean sloughed papillae. In IVU film, we also must comment in the ureter, the normal course of the ureter in both sides along the transverse process of the vertebra. The transverse process. The abnormality of the course of the ureters may be medialization or lateralization. In this case, both double G stents are seen inside the ureter, and both are overlie the renal, the vertebra, the pedicle, both sides. The cause of medialization of the ureter may be retroperitoneal fibrosis, but here the both ureters are lateralized, and lateralization diagnosed if the ureter away from the transverse process by 1.5 centimeter. So there is lateralization in this case, which may be due to large retroperitoneal mass. In this case, the left kidney and the left ureter appear normal, whereas the right kidney show resistant to nephrogram, and increased the density by the time, and the excretion occur after many hours, and there is mild hydroureteronephrosis of the right kidney down to in the splenic X-ray. We search for the cause of the obstruction, which appear here in this field, which is right ureteric stone. So the diagnosis of this case, right pelvic ureteric stone and proximal hydroureteronephrosis. In this case, we have moderate hydroureteronephrosis, and there is large filling defect appear here in the right iliac ureter. This filling defect, which is attached to the wall of the ureter, this filling defect by ureteroscope, we diagnose right ureteric tumor. And the last, also in IVU, we must comment on the lower urinary tract, the urinary bladder. In this film, the urinary bladder appeared normal, adequate bladder capacity and regular contour. But in this case, there is irregularities in the urinary bladder, which may be due to chronic cystitis or lower urinary tract obstruction. Also, there is multiple diverticulae arising from the right lateral bladder wall. And the last film in IVU, and which is the one of the important film, which is post-micturition film, to comment on the, it's more important in male than female, to comment on the post-voiding residual urine, which is the important sign in old patient in prostatic enlargement. This is an example for splenic X-ray film with calcification at the wall in the wall of the urinary bladder. After doing IVU film, there is a large filling defect, filling most of the cavity of the urinary bladder, which is mostly urothelial tumor. Another example for right lateral wall, large filling defect, which is urinary bladder tumor. In some cases, in full bladder film, we cannot see the filling defect, which appear at after micturition film, like this case. In this, if we see this case, we report that it is no filling defect, but it appear well at post micturition film. There is large filling defect related to left lateral bladder wall, which is bladder tumor. And lastly, the contraindication for IVU are high serum creatinine, pregnancy, in allergic patients, hepatorenal syndrome, multiple myeloma, and thyrotoxicosis. The third item is imaging of the urinary bladder cystography, urethrography, imaging of the urethra, and the combined technique for imaging of both bladder and urethra, which is cyst urethrography, either ascending or retrograde imaging. The importance of avoiding cyst urethrography It is more important in children in some situation like voiding function in child or antenatal hydronephrosis to diagnose the cause. It may be posterior visceral valve or in patient with recurrent urinary tract infection, toxic fluid, vesicoureteric reflux. In cystogram, we must comment on the bladder capacity, either increased or decreased, bladder contour, absence or presence of voiding or vesicoureteric reflux, evaluation of detection of or absence of bladder lesion like urine bladder masses or stones or urethral seal in children, presence of bladder diverticuli, in some cases of bladder trauma, to diagnose the contrast leak, and the presence of urinary tract fistulas between the bladder and the uterus or vagina, vasico-vaginal or vasico-uterine fistulas in female or vasico-colonic fistulas in male or female. And lastly, after doing micturition fill, we must comment on urethral, the appearance of the urethra, either there is urethral structure or posterior urethral valve. This is the normal appearance of the urinary bladder in cystogram. We fill the bladder via urethral catheter, and there is the normal capacity of the urinary bladder. It fills the pelvic cavity, and there is a normal contour of the urinary bladder, no diverticuli, and no vasico-uretic reflux bilateral. The ureters are not seen. This is a film in children. By filling the urinary bladder, there is filling defect of the, at the right lateral bladder wall. In children, filling defect in children mostly means urethral seal, while in adult maybe ureteric, maybe urinary bladder tumor or radiolucent stone. There is a question about the capacity of the urinary bladder in children, which is age in years plus 2 multiplied by 30. So if I have a child, say 5 years, so the bladder capacity may be 5 plus 2 means 10 multiplied by 30. So the bladder capacity in 5 years is 300 cc. If the bladder capacity is smaller than this, plus 2 multiplied by 6.
So if the child is 5 years, 5 plus 2 equals 7.
7, yes. If the child 5 years plus 2 is 7 multiplied by 30 to 210 cc. If the size of the or the bladder, I can calculate this amount during filling of the urinary bladder by saline mixed by contrast media. So if the bladder take more than this, so it is means increased bladder capacity, or less than this, it means reduced bladder capacity. Like in this case, there is increased bladder capacity along its longitudinal axis. The bladder reaching the lower abdominal region, and the wall of the urinary bladder appear irregular and serrated outline. It occurs in cases of lower urinary tract obstruction in children, in cases of posterior urethral valve due to urinary tract obstruction. And also in this case, there is reduced bladder capacity. It appears smaller in size, and there is bilateral vasico-ureteric reflux. Here the ureter appears on the right side, and the contrast reaching the pelvic calcium system, and the left kidney also, the left ureter appears, and the contrast reaching the renal pelvis of the left side. And there, this diagram shows the grading of the vasico-ureteric reflux. First grade, if the contrast reaching the ureter, if it opacifies the pelvic calcium system, but the pelvic calcium system remain preserved its covering, it means it grade 2. Flattening of the calyces, grade 3. loss of loss flattened mild hydronephrosis means grade 4 while grade 5 dilatation and tortuosity of the ureter and the marked ballooning of the calyces grade 5 vesicular ureteric reflux. In this case there is large increased bladder capacity and the bilateral grade 4 vesicular ureteric reflux, the calyces loss of its covering and the appear there is a beer balloon but the ureter not dilated, so it is grade 4 vesicular ureteric reflux bilaterally. While in this case of a child, there is increased bladder capacity and this is the right ureter which is markedly dilated and all of the contrast reaches the ureter. And in my study I don't wait to fill the kidney, but if the ureter appears dilated and markedly dilated and tortuous, this is the indication of grade 5 vesicular ureteric reflux without opacification of the kidney, because it will take more contrast media and which may be the child can't excrete it, so it may be make some complication in the child grade 5 right vesicular ureteric reflux. Urethral graft, this diagram shows the anatomy of the urethra. This is the benign urethra, bulbous urethra, membranous, and the last is the posterior urethra, which is prostatic urethra. Here, this is retrograde urethrography. I inject contrast media from outside, and this is the benign urethra, and this is the bulbous urethra, membranous urethra, prostatic urethra. And there is in the anatomy this filling defect, which is veromontanum, in which the ejaculatory duct opening here in the prostatic urethra. And this is the urinary bladder. Okay, benign, bulbous, membranous, and the prostatic urethra. This is retrograde urethrography, and this film is anti-grade urethrography. By doing a micturition film at the end of the cystogram, the means that is normal urination, and while this is retrograde injection of contrast media. By comparing both views, the posterior urethra here not dilated, while in this film the posterior urethra is dilated. Bladder neck, prostatic urethra, membranous, bulbous, and benign urethra. Example of pathology in the bulbous urethra, which is structure here in the bulbous urethra, long segment structure. Benign urethra appear normal, and posterior urethra appear normal, but there is a structure in the posterior urethra. Another imaging technique, which is anti-grade bilography in patient with BCN. We inject contrast media via BCN. It opacifies the pelvical cell system and the ureter down to structure here. There is complete arrest of the contrast media. In this patient, there is pathology here in the ureter, and the urologist needs to know if he can remove this BCN or not. But after doing this film, there is the complete obstruction, so the BCN of value here. So the study done via anti-grade injection of contrast media. The other is retrograde bilography by injection of contrast media via ureteroscope. We inject contrast media from here, and this is the ureter. Okay, but there is filling defect here in the pelvic ureter, which is pelvic ureteric tumor. And another large filling defect appear here in the lower calyces and the renal pelvis, which is multiple urothelial tumor in the pelvic ureter and at the lower calyx and the renal pelvis. Another study, which is lobogram in patient with ileal loop conduit, we inject contrast media through the opening of the ileal loop I will add the skin and the opacification of both ureters and both kidneys to diagnose any pathology like stones or ureteric tumor. If we not need the two in patient with after radical cystectomy and doing ileal loop conduit, we may cannot inject contrast media at CT or MRI. So this logogram may be of good value to diagnose the recurrence or the presence of urothelial tumor without harmful effect to the patient. Harmful effect on the patient if he do CT with contrast or MRI with contrast. Another example for doing the lobogram. Here, this is the ileal lobe, and this is right ureter, right pelvic ileal system, and the left pelvic ileal system. And lastly, thank you for your attention. Any question?
So at the end of this presentation, I would like to thank and appreciate the efforts of Dr. Abdullah. So it is very nice presentation. I encourage all of you, if you have any question, to ask him. But I would like to start with a question. I am so pleased that we have with us today, Professor Donia. The question, Professor Donia, as an expert and consultant of nephrology, what's your impression about the value of IVU for nephrologists, Dr. Donia?
Thank you, Professor Hussein. And first, I'd like to congratulate you for this outstanding, fascinating Congress. So as you have mentioned, I think in at least in nephrology, we don't use the IVU a lot. We believe that there are many alternatives to at least diagnose
case,
yeah, to avoid contrast. I don't know if urology is still
here. Are they still asking for IVU?
In some cases, like as well, we want to know the anatomy of the kidney, anterior or posterior, in cases of BCNL. And as well, mostly, this is the main indication nowadays for this, for IVU.
So, Dr. Abdullah, if the rate of the use of IVU here in the center is limited?
Limited nowadays. Comparing to previous,
this is because the availability of CT and MRI.
And MRI.
Okay, thank you. I think the most important sector you discussed is the micturating cyst retrogram.
Yes.
Because here we, our school, MCUG is the standard of care for preparing recipients for transplantation, and a sector in neurology, they requested for patients for children with recurrent with IETC to document reflux. And if we document advanced reflux, and I like your figures about the degrees of reflux.
Yes.
If we have advanced degrees, our routine here is to do nephroureterectomy before transplantation.
Yes.
If it's unilateral, we will do unilateral for the left side, and then to proceed for, after that for right transplantation. If it's bilateral, we'll start with the left side, then the right side.
Okay,
and if it is if it is mild reflux, I think there is some cases that we use silicone injection.
Okay.
Dr. Nahal, do you have a question?
Yes. I just want to ask about the last slide. What we will detect the malignant in the muscle.
Okay. So Dr. Nahal asks about the last slide. So let us to share the last slide again. And
This
in this case no malignancy, but the malignancy in this case no malignancy. I detect the malignancy if there is any feeling defect along the if ureter in the lobogram it can replace in some patient in the patient after doing radical cystectomy and area looking we this patient more are more the patients are more liable for renal impairment and high serum creatinine. So lobogram of value for detection of recurrence of urothelial tumor as a replacement for CTOS contrast or MRI. But I show this case for knowledge only, no pathology in this case.
So there is no tumor.
No tumor.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Abdullah. Is there any question from the audience? Dr. Mutasim, is there any candidate raising a hand? Everything is clear? So thank you very much, Dr. Abdullah. Thank you. This is very interesting. Just a few seconds and we will start the second presentation. شوف البرزنتيشن ظهر عندك ولا كده معتصم عايز تخلص من دي على ايه دي So to start the second presentation, this is a very interesting presentation and very important. Why? Because the topic is very important for nephrologists. How to diagnose renal artery stenosis? Because there is a sector of patients who present with refractory hypertension and we may detect the cause as a renal artery stenosis. So the topic is important to all nephrologists. The second, the speaker here, I am pleased and honored to know Dr. Hashim. Why? Because Dr. Hashim, he is a specialist of consultant of radiology here at the Urology and Nephrology Center, and he is characterized by a humane approach. He is very dedicated, enthusiastic, and always at the help of the patients and his colleagues. So we love him very much, and we like to collaborate with him because he is a model and always share me in the hemodialysis courses, as you see in the beginning, one of his photos. So I'm very happy, Dr. Hashim, to have you today to speak about the imaging of aortic stenosis and the stage. Is to you.
Thank you.
Hypertension is one of the most common worldwide diseases, representing a major risk factor for the development of cardiovascular disease. Renovascular hypertension accounts for about 5% of hypertensive patients. The major cause of renovascular hypertension is renal artery stenosis. The most common cause of renal artery stenosis is atherosclerosis. The next most common cause is fibromuscular dysplasia. Less common etiology of renal vascular hypertension include vasculitis, compression from outside the kidney, renal artery aneurysm, and post-traumatic occlusion. Atherosclerotic renal artery stenosis, which accounts for about 90% of cases, is usually ostial and involves the proximal third of the renal artery. Risk factors of atherosclerotic renal artery stenosis include smoking, hypertension, diabetes, and hyperlipidemia. On the other hand, fibromuscular dysplasia, which represents less than 5% of cases with renal artery stenosis, tend to affect middle-aged females and involve the middle and distal two-thirds of renal artery. It is characterized by a string of beads appearance on angiography. As we know, renin is released from the kidney in response to renal ischemia. Renin acts local and in systemic circulation on angiotensinogen to form angiotensin 1. Angiotensin 1 produces angiotensin 2, which is vasoconstrictive element of renovascular hypertension. Angiotensin 2 increases also adrenal gland production of aldosterone with subsequent retention of sodium and water. We should suspect renal artery stenosis if there's severe hypertension under age of 40, sudden onset and short duration of hypertension, hypertension that is difficult to control, unexplained renal impairment, and unexplained atrophic kidney. Radiological modalities available for diagnosis of renal artery stenosis are divided into non-invasive methods, such as ultrasound and Doppler, CT angio, MR angiography, and renal scintigraphy. However, conventional renal angiography, which is the gold standard for diagnosis of renal artery stenosis, is considered as an invasive technique. Renal ultrasound is the initial first step in investigation of renal artery stenosis. It is simple, non-invasive, inexpensive, and widely available methods. Ultrasound can easily detect size disparity between both kidneys and exclude structural abnormalities. We can see the difference between normal kidney and the kidney with renal artery stenosis. In normal kidney, the kidney size is normal and parenchyma echogenicity is normal. However, in kidney with renal artery stenosis, there is a small size and increased parenchyma echogenicity. Normal renal Doppler wave has rapid systolic peak and high diastolic flow. When we perform a renal Doppler study, the kidney is divided into three zones, upper, middle, and lower zones. We start to study intra-renal arteries, then study the main renal artery. The normal peak systolic velocity in main renal artery is accepted up to 120 centimeters per second. The acceleration time is the time from start of systole to reach the peak. Normal acceleration time in renal artery is accepted up to 0.07 seconds. The Doppler criteria of renal artery stenosis include direct and indirect criteria. Direct criteria or proximal criteria seen in the mean renal artery at site of stenosis, and indirect criteria or distal criteria seen in intrarenal artery. The most important direct ultrasound sign in diagnosis of renal artery stenosis is the increase in peak systolic velocity more than 180 centimeters per second. Other criteria include renal to aortic ratio more than 3.5, post-stenotic turbulent flow, and lack of color flow in cases of occlusion. In this color Doppler image, we can see the elevated peak systolic velocity of renal Doppler wave more than 300 centimeters per second. The indirect ultrasound sign or distal criteria seen in intrarenal arteries include loss of early systolic peak, increased acceleration time, decrease in acceleration index, and difference between both kidneys resistive index more than 5%. In renal artery stenosis, the change in renal Doppler wave can be seen in the form of increase in the acceleration time and delay systolic peak. Acceleration time is the time from the start of stall to the peak. Here we can see the difference in acceleration time between normal and abnormal wave. As mentioned before, the acceleration time increase and the acceleration index decrease in renal artery stenosis. This is normal renal Doppler wave. However, this abnormal wave suggests presence of renal artery stenosis. Another case with more advanced renal artery stenosis. In renal artery stenosis, post-stenotic turbulent flow is noted due to passage of blood flow, so now segment with high velocity. Post-stenotic turbulent flow is seen distal to site of stenosis in patient with right renal artery stenosis. Also, this is abnormal renal Doppler wave in patient with right renal artery long segment stenosis confirmed by conventional angiogram. Another case with proximal left renal artery stenosis, we can see the abnormal Doppler wave. In this case, the abnormal renal Doppler wave suggests presence of kidney transplant artery stenosis and confirmed by MR angio and conventional angiogram. This slide summarizes the Doppler criteria of renal artery stenosis. As mentioned before, the peak systolic velocity is elevated and seen in the mean renal artery. However, the increased acceleration time is seen distal to the stenotic segment at intrarenal visit. Now we will discuss MR angiography, which is non-invasive high-resolution imaging modality to evaluate renal artery stenosis. Contrast-enhanced contrast agents are used to perform MRI of renal artery, but non-contrast MR angio with a special technique has also been used to evaluate the renal artery. Contrast-enhanced MR angio image showing proximal right renal artery stenosis. This also coronal contact enhanced MR angle showing bilateral renal artery stenosis and also there is stenosis in the proximal left common carotid artery. Another case of bilateral renal artery stenosis, more severe at right side. In this image, we can see the post stenotic dilatation distal to site of stenosis at the left renal artery. Contrast enhanced MRN is limited in patients with renal impairment due to risk of nephrogenic systemic fibrosis, which is a fatal disease affecting the skin, muscle, and internal organs. Now we will discuss CT angio, which provides anatomic diagnosis of renal artery stenosis. It is non-invasive, rapid, and multi-planar imaging technique. The disadvantages of this technique are its ionizing radiation and its use of nephrotoxic contrast material. CT angio is limited in high serum creatinine, hypersensitivity to contrast media, and repeated exposure to radiation. Coronal reformatted CT angio showing stenosis at middle of left renal artery with post stenotic dilatation. Coronal 3D reformatted CT angio showing stenosis at right renal artery. Axial and the coronal reformatted CT angio showing focal stenosis at proximal right renal artery, and we also see infrarenal aneurysm in the aorta associated with multiple atherosclerotic changes. Axial CT angio and the coronal 3D reformatted CT angio image showing the atrophic left kidney with a small left renal artery. Axial CT image and axial oblique CT angio, coronal reformatted CT angio showing left renal artery stenosis confirmed by conventional angiogram. This is a characteristic fibromuscular dysplasia appearance, string of feet appearance in middle-aged female. This is coronal CT angio image, and this is convention image. In this axial CT angio image, we can see intimal flap extending into right and left renal artery, suggesting the diagnosis of renal artery dysfunction. The renal artery stenosis can be classified into 5 degrees according to percentage of stenosis. If we know the normal caliber at the base stenotic segment and caliber of stenosis, we can calculate the percentage of stenosis. Conventional angiogram, which is considered the gold standard, conventional angiogram is considered the gold standard for demonstrating renal artery stenosis. In this flush aortogram, we can see proximal left renal artery stenosis, selective right renal angiogram showing stenosis at middle of right renal artery, coronal reformatted MR angio showing double right renal artery. There is eccentric atherometric plaque seen adjacent to right upper renal artery. Also, there is bilateral renal artery stenosis conventional angiogram confirmed the MRI diagnosis. Bilateral renal artery, stenosis, and atherometal plate adjacent to right upper renal artery. Another case with more severe stenosis, long segment stenosis seen at coronal contrast enhanced MR angio. And after conventional angio, there was overestimation of the stenosis at MR angio. Characteristic strength of which the appearance of fibromuscular dysplasia at MR angio and the conventional angiogram. Another case of bilateral renal artery stenosis. The kidney is small, the left kidney is small in size, suggesting more severe stenosis at left side, and conventional angiogram confirms presence of severe stenosis at left kidney than right one. Coronally formatted CT angio showing long segment right renal artery stenosis. Patient was the first to perform conventional angiogram and then angioplasty was carried out with stent fixation. Post angioplasty image confirmed adequate dilatation of the stenotic segment. Another case of left renal artery stenosis. The same case after angioplasty with adequate dilatation of the stenotic segment. This is the stent. Another case of right renal artery stenosis before and after stent fixation. This case of bilateral renal artery stenosis, more severe at right side. Angioplasty and stent fixation was carried out in both renal arteries. His inhibitor scintigraphy is the functional assessment of renal perfusion in patients with unilateral renal artery stenosis. Unilateral change in renal function induced by ACE inhibition can be revealed with scintigraphy. In this patient, ACE inhibitor induced significant changes in time activity curve of the affected kidney in comparison with baseline scintigraphy. This baseline scintigraphy showing mild changes in left renal curve, there's a mild decrease in the amplitude and delayed peaking in left renal curve in comparison to right renal curve. After administration of captopril, there's more decrease in uptake of left kidney and more changes in the curve of left kidney, denoting presence of left renal artery stenosis. Captopril scintigraphy is limited in bilateral renal artery stenosis, impaired renal function, urinary tract obstruction, and chronic intake of ACE inhibitor. Diagnosis of renal artery stenosis should begin with Doppler ultrasound. CT angio and MR angio are both effective modalities for anatomic diagnosis of renal artery stenosis. Non-contrast MR angio. Non-contrast MR angio protocols are an alternative in patients with impaired renal function. Renal scintigraphy also can be applied for functional assessment of renal artery stenosis. Conventional angiography is the gold standard in diagnosis of renal artery stenosis. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much to Hashim for this very illustrative presentation. It is very nice. You didn't leave anything. You presented all the radiology diagnostic tools for the diagnosis of the renal artery stenosis. But the questions from the nephrologist side So we'll ask you one or two questions, and we'll leave you for the biopsy that you are going to do. If there is any question to Dr. Hashim from the floor or from the candidates online, I'll be happy. Dr. Ahmed Fikri, fadda.
First of all, my congratulations to my professor and my colleague Dr. Hussein Shaisha and Dr. Tariq Yasti, and all members participating in this workshop.
Thank you very much.
My question about the color Doppler in renal artery stenosis. If I examine the intrarenal vessels and the color Doppler display dam in the flow, display dam in the flow, yani monophasic flow. Okay. It is sufficient to confirm the diagnosis of renal artery stenosis as a screening test, yeah, or I must examine all phases of examination.
Yes. Presence of damp in the wave suggests the presence of the stenosis. Even we detect it in segmental artery or the main renal artery. So if I see the damp in the wave, I should refer patient to other modalities such as CT angio or MR angio.
I can't suspect renal artery stenosis.
Yes, you should confirm the diagnosis with other modalities such as CT angio or MR angio.
Dr. Ahmed, for this,
I am very happy to see you, Dr. Ahmed.
Dr. Ahmed,
okay.
You touched an important point. I think the for the success of Doppler as a screening tool for the diagnosis would depend upon professional ultrasound person who is mastering the technique, and he should screen the main artery and it is not just to look at the damping wave, because sometimes there is some points that can simulate renal artery stenosis. For example, if we have fistula induced by prior biopsy, we will find a low resistive index. But in this point, we refer to the points with potassium. We should consider time to peak velocity and in the presence of fistula, the time to peak velocity is not prolonged or not delayed. The peak is not delayed in the presence of fistula. But the diastolic flow is high, so at the end of the day, resistive index will be low, like renal artery stenosis. But the time to peak velocity is normal, so this is taken into consideration. Sometimes in the presence of salivary kidney, and there is atherosclerosis of the aorta or iliac vessels, we may have data of the Doppler simulating renal artery stenosis. This is why, if we pick the diagnosis by Doppler, we should shift to the higher modalities like MRI or CT, MR angiography or CT angiography. And after releasing Dr. Hashim, I'll continue with you regarding the nephrology perspectives of these diagnostic facilities. Because Dr. Hashim should move now to the biopsy because he has a patient for graft biopsy, I continue with you the discussion, and I'd like to thank him very much for this excellent presentation. Thank you, Dr. Hashim. Regarding the nephrology points of view, I have some points. The first point, ultrasound is important even without Doppler and screening. If we have small kidney, even if there is renal artery stenosis, at the end of the day, if we will do intervention, it may be for resistant hypertension, maybe nephrectomy. And this is the only benefit of angiography, of renogram. So the use of captopril renogram nowadays is very restricted. For my opinion, I never request renogram to diagnose renal artery stenosis. But if I have relatively small kidney, I want to know split function or the contribution of this kidney to the overall GFR to allow me for the decision of nephrectomy, unilateral nephrectomy,
in the presence of refractory hypertension. This is one point. Regarding CTA or MRA, Nihal, which is better, is superior. So we have the two modalities are fine for diagnosis. CT and geography, especially with the newer imaging, may be more precise in delineating the visits. But the expense is radiation and the use of iodinated contrast. MRA is without radiation. There is no risk of radiation. So I calculate the cost benefit, and then I use the technique that the center is mastering. So even in the preparing for transplantation, since 20 years, we replaced the IVU by MR. We did MRI, MR urography, MR angiography, etc. Nowadays, we have preference towards CT, because with CT, we can have CT angiography, CT urography with better delineation. So according to the availability, but don't forget, CT means radiation and the use of iodinated contrast. MR, at the other hand, need to have the technique and without radiation. But the invasive angiography nowadays is very restricted too. So we don't do invasive angiography, except if we think of intervention. And the last point for this long commentary, we don't recommend interventional maneuvers for renal artery stenosis, except if we calculate the benefit or to predict the benefit of doing revascularization by intervention. If you want to ask Nihal, please come here. Because sometimes correction of the stenotic segment by intervention doesn't solve the problem of hypertension, especially if it is long-standing hypertension. So we leave the intervention for patients with flash pulmonary edema, acute renal failure, or if we use medical treatment with ACE inhibitor or ARBs, etc., for urinary artery stenosis, we'll find acute kidney injury. In these three scenarios, this is the classic indication for intervention. But to do intervention for all, I'm against this trend.
If I have a patient with the unilateral small size kidney.
Yes.
And this patient, they have hypertension, but controlled by antihypertensive. I proceed to see if there is the renal artery stenosis in the other kidney or not.
Very nice question. So if you have renal artery stenosis in the appearing normal kidney by ultrasound, and the hypertension is quite controlled by medical treatment, I think it is out of favor because the patient is controlled. But if you witness any uncontrolled, you may have now controlled the hypertension because there is no significant stenosis. After a bit of time, the stenosis may increase and become significant, leading to uncontrolling of hypertension. In this moment, I investigate.
But I have a unilateral small size kidney, I have only one kidney, is normal. So
Presence of normal kidney and the small kidney, Dr. Nihal wants to add to the indications for intervention is to have solitary function kidney. No, I don't agree, because in this solitary kidney, if the patient has controlled the blood pressure by one or two medications, so everything is fine, especially if this is chronic hypertension, and it's chronic hypertension because I lost one kidney from my aortic stenosis, so it's chronic hypertension, easily controlled by medications. If you think of doing intervention to keep the normal kidney, appearing kidney, for long period, I can say to you, in the intervention, you will inject dye, and you do dissection, and you may lose this kidney.
And so we leave, in this scenario, we leave intervention for acute compelling indications, like severe hypertension uncontrolled because the patient's life may be threatened, acute heart failure, acute renal failure, or acute renal failure with medication. And I leave the decision for nephrectomy in this case scenario because the blood pressure is controlled. If in this scenario, small kidney, normal size kidney, and the blood pressure is uncontrolled, I may think of removing this small kidney by nephrectomy after doing renogram to know the sharing to the total GFR. And this is from my opinion and from my practice here at this center. When we have case of renal stenosis, I request a renogram nowadays, just only in this scenario, to know the contribution of this small kidney. We have 5 minutes for further questions. For the pediatric, for the intervention, during intervention for renal artery stenosis, I think respective, because I didn't review the guidelines in pediatric, but irrespective to the age, if I don't have these compelling indication, it's better not to play with the vessels, because intervention is not a solution for all cases, but it is a solution whenever indicated. Why I am saying this concept in this solid manner, this depends upon my readings for the landmark trials that assessed the results of intervention. No superiority in the majority of these intervention studies for this scenario. Okay, don't forget, intervention means angiography, invasive maneuver, complications. So I carry the risk, I accept the risk if I am expecting the benefit. If you have any question from the online, Dr. Mu'tasim, please tell me. على صوتك ما تصل. Safety. It depends upon the configuration of the patient. Suppose that you have, and depends upon the kidney. We have graft, kidney allograft. It is easier for ultrasound than the native kidneys. And if you have a patient with 150 kilogram. And at this point, even you cannot see the kidney well. So, and if you don't have a well acquainted and a professional Doppler doctor, at this moment, you cannot depend. So the sensitivity is not so sensitive, but it's a good tool because it gives an impression. If you have a clinical suspicion for renal artery stenosis, go ahead for MR angiography or CT angiography according to the kidney function. Is there any question, Dr. Mu'tasim? Value of resistive index. This is one of the data referred to the diagnosis of renal stenosis, as Dr. Hashim mentioned. When we put the probe on the main artery, in the main artery we'll find high velocity, but the resistive index is for the intrarenal vessels. So I do Doppler for intrarenal vessels. For intrarenal vessels, I depend upon 2 points. Time to peak velocity, it will be delayed, and the resistive index, it will be small, low. If the normal resistive index is, for example, 0.7 or 0.6, here you can find it 0.4, 0.3. Why resistive index is small? Because the wave is small. So it is dampened wave. Tardus means the delayed time to big velocity, and the barvas is small wave. So resistive index is low. But for the differential diagnosis of low resistive index, don't forget to put the causes that I mentioned with Dr. Hashim, like fistula induced by prior biopsy. But in this point, you will not find the time to big velocity delayed or prolonged. So resistive index is fine here because few causes can lead to low resistive index. But high resistive index is sometimes are due to many causes, especially in transplant cases. Maybe because of the echographer makes some compression to the graft, this can increase resistive index. There is drug nephrotoxicity, increase resistive index. Bilonephritis, increase resistive index. Rejection, increase resistive index. Renal vein thrombosis, increase resistive index. All these are causes of increased resistive index, but low resistive index is stenosis, fistula, or main art, or the connection with the native vessels like iliac or others, atherosclerosis. Is there any question? So at this point, I thank all the attendees, either with us here at the Urology and Nephrology Center or online. Thank you very much, and we hope that the message was clear this day, and inshallah, we will meet again in the near future for a more fruitful presentation. Thank you and goodbye.